adjustment. Next week, I have another engagement that I sort of felt I needed to get to, and we're going to have communion next Sunday. The first Sunday is obviously what you talk about, and appreciate your change. So maybe you didn't know you were going to do that the first Sunday of August. So I said, can we move it a week ahead? And you're here, wonderful. So thanks for your understanding. Thanks for your patience. Thanks for not getting all worked up, Jesse.
No problem.
He said between motorcycles and a black van this morning, it's driving me nuts. I was here a little bit ahead of time. I just took a few minutes out of the car before I came in. So it was good. I didn't panic. We just got here and it was in good hands. Mm-hmm. I want to draw your attention this morning to just one verse. In fact, you probably know I'm not really that smart. So the last time I was here, I only spoke on one verse. You are salt. And this time I'm going to only speak on, actually, it's a half of a verse. Guys smarter than me, like Jesse, they can take a whole parable, and they can take a whole chapter. I just can only take a little bit at a time. It's good. I'm going to look at a verse in John 13, verse 1. John 13 and verse 1. It talks about it begins in John 13 about the Passover feast. And if you look at the last sentence in that first verse, it says this: having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them the full extent of his love. That's the verse, the sentence, not the verse, that's the half verse, that's the sentence I'm going to look at. Having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them the full extent of his love. There are three phrases there, and I want to look at those three phrases and just sort of bring us into the time of communion before the Lord. And sort of help us realize a little bit what he thinks of us and why this is all happening. It's not happening because of us. It's happening in spite of us. We need this. He also needed to do what he did because we need this. So let's look at those verses, the sentence this morning. Having loved his own who were in the world. When I look at that, the timing of that means that something happened in the past. Having loved his own who were in the world. It tells us that somewhere back in history, God had something in mind. And we know that began back in the book of Genesis. When sin entered the world and it sort of messed all of us up, and what we're doing here in this journey in life is trying not to mess up as much as we want to. I really like my dad's theology. He was a plumber, but he was a great theologian in his own down-to-earth kind of way. And I remember talking to him one time and saying, Dad, and I'm just a little toddler. I'm probably about 12 or 13 years old. Starting to think about life and, you know, what's right and wrong. And I probably should have thought sooner than that. But I said, life isn't easy. And he said, does it get any easier when you get older? Now, again, what do I know as a, 12, 13-year-old? You know, life is really tough at 12 and 13. I had so many things to worry about. You know, make sure I'm home in time for supper. Make sure I, get a bath and those kinds of nasty things. And he said to me, I'll say it like this. He said, before he became a Christian, he said he was a stinker. And he said, when I became a Christian, I was still a stinker. But I'm just hoping that as I get a little bit older and learn a little bit more about God and what he wants, I'm just less of a stinker than I used to be. I thought, that's pretty good theology. We're on this road trying to do the best we can. We mess it up. I just boogered it up once in a while. And sometimes I really boogered it up badly. But I'm grateful that there was a time in history when, having loved me, before I was even born, before I was even in my mother's womb, he knew I'd be here today, standing before you. He knew the decisions I would make. journey. Hasn't been the sweetest one for his sake. I still word it up. And my guess is you do too. We just hope we're not as much of a stinker as we used to be. When I look at God's love for me, the fact that having done this, so it's sort of a, I think of the word covenant and the promises that God made to me. Now, a covenant is when two people agree on something. And in our way of thinking, covenants are mutual agreements. I go to Turkey Hill, and I want to buy a gallon of milk. And I give, or put my credit card, whatever way, I give them, I'm going to say whatever the price might be today or was, but round figures, $3.50 for a gallon of milk. So I give them $3.50. And they give me something of equal value. They give me $3.50 worth of milk. When I buy a car, I use a round figure, $20,000. I go to a car dealer, and I want to buy a car, and I have $20,000, and I tell a car dealer, that's what I have. I want to buy a car that's worth $20,000. I'm trusting him to give me a vehicle that's worth $20,000, not one that's worth $15,000 or $12,000 or even $19,000. And so that's what we think about covenants or promises or contracts. But let me tell you something rather unique about God's covenants. I don't think there's one of them that's of equal value. I don't think there's one of them that says, you give me this and I'll give you something of equal value in return. If we give him our sins, we confess our sins unto God, what does he give us in return? Forgiveness. Is that equal? I mess up. I do it intentionally sometimes. I know I'm doing it. I do it anyway. And I say, I'm sorry. Do I get punishment in return, or do I get forgiveness? Psalm says they cried to God in their trouble. And what did he do? He delivered them. Is that equality? I don't think so. Come to me, all you who have burdens and are heavy laden, and I will give you what? Rest. That's humble. Pretty good deal as far as I can see. If we lack wisdom, what are we supposed to do? Work hard? Get out the books and study? Ask him. And he'll give it to us how? Freely. Abundantly. Songwriter says it this way. Put on the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. There's nothing cool about that. And so we see that all throughout Scripture, when God says, you do this and I'll do this, we're not talking equality. We're talking God's goodness and God's grace, and God going above and beyond what we can ever imagine. See, covenants are supposed to be in equal terms, so we think. But God doesn't deal with human economy. In fact, he tells us, Jesus' own words in the New Testament, that we are to give. And when we give, and give, and give, we might think we're really giving a whole lot, and how does he give in return? He opens up the windows of heaven and pours out such a blessing that you can't. We give, and he blesses in the same amount, times 10. Well, about 100-fold. That's just the way God is. And he does that for us all the time. And the fact that knowing God will always keep his promises, and knowing the fact that God just goes beyond what I comprehend or think when I do anything, spiritual realm for him, I'm not going to be able to understand the return I'm going to get, the blessings that come my way. A number of years ago, probably a little over 25 years ago, my wife and I took a vacation and we went out to San Francisco. And of course, one of the sights you need to see when you go to San Francisco is the Golden Gate Bridge. Now, if you've never been there, or if you have been, chances are you really spend your morning and part of the afternoon doing other things like riding the trolley, because the mist is so heavy and deep over the bay, you can't always see the bridge until the sun finally burns it off. Sometime maybe noon or later. Maybe if you're lucky, it'll be a little earlier than noon, but typically when we were there, we could not see the full Golden Gate Bridge and the sky above it until sometime in the mid or late afternoon. Well, we took a tour, and a guy was taking us on the Golden Gate Bridge or to it and across it, and he told us this story about the Golden Gate Bridge. He said, while they were building that bridge, he said, they were only halfway finished with building the bridge, and 23 men had fallen off the bridge into the bay and died. Halfway, completion of the bridge, 23 men fell off the structure into the bay and died. Work was slowing down. Guys were becoming a little bit overly cautious. Mistakes were being made. That happens when you become too cautious. And the progress was really dwindling. And so the architects decided that what they would do is they would put this huge net underneath the span of the bridge so that if anyone fell, hopefully they would fall into the net and they wouldn't die. Well, what they found was that after they put up the net under the bridge, only 10 men fell off the structure. None of them died. And interestingly, you don't need to be a rocket scientist to understand this, but they finished the second half of the bridge in half the time it took them to finish the first half. Why? They knew. They knew it was okay to fail. They knew it was okay to mess up. They knew it was okay to get a little sloppy and to slip and fall, because if they did, they'd be caught in this net. And they would climb back up on the structure and they'd keep on working. Now that reminds me of God and his promise to me that he will not let me fall. And in the words of Moses in Deuteronomy, he says that under his wings are the everlasting arms. And I sort of picture myself walking on life, going across the bridge of life, and messing up and falling. And what happens when I fall? What happens when I get sloppy in my Christian walk? What happens when I just start to get careless and I slip and I fall? You see, it's not death for me. But rather, I'm caught in the everlasting arms of Jesus. And he puts me back up on that bridge of life and says, now keep going, keep working, keep plugging. Just try to be a little bit more careful next time. Don't be so sloppy, but it's okay. And just knowing that really has encouraged me in my Christian walk. I don't have to worry about being zapped by God, who some see him as a cosmological policeman, waiting for you to do something wrong, and then all of a sudden he's going to nail you for it. Rather, I see it as a God who says, do the best you can. And when you slip and fall, it's okay. Because I'm going to put you back out there on that bridge again, and I'm going to have to keep on plugging, keep on working, keep on going. Having loved his own who were in the world, God told me he would love. He made that promise to me, and his promise, his covenant with me, is far beyond my comprehension of a covenant. And the more I fall, the more he picks me up. Does that mean I should get sloppy and it's okay to be careless? No. Paul tells us that. Can we sin more because God's grace is so good? No, that's not the way it works. But when you do fall, when you do mess up, it's okay. Having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them. Now he's talking about a present tense. John is telling us that something Jesus did after he wrote this book was something that he sort of was doing there in the present for him. I want to make a statement. I'm going to talk about that statement. A statement that I heard from a minister one time, and I thought about it and I liked it. And it goes like this. A person performs on the expectation of the one they love the most. A person performs on the expectation of the one they love the most. In other words, the one that you love the most is the one you try to please and you live for and you love. Now, growing up, my job, along with my brothers, he was a year older than me, our job on a Sunday after church, we come home, we have a big dinner. His job and mine was to do dishes. I hated dishes. I hated dishwater. I hated dish suds. I hated dishcloths, dish towels. I hated the food that sort of floated around in the wash pan that we put in the sink back in those days. I hated absolutely everything there was about dishes. And we were allowed, after we came home and after we ate, we were allowed to go outside for a little while and play because we lived at the corner of an alley. And it's on that alley where our neighbors used to come out, the guys used to come out and play baseball. And so we'd play and we'd use a tennis ball and we'd play baseball. And I remember hitting a ball that would make Aaron Judge look sick. I don't know Aaron Judge, but he's about 6'7", about 250, I don't know what he is, but he hits these massive home runs. Mike Trout would have been impressed with me. I mean, this ball must have traveled 20 feet in the air. And because it was an alley and it wasn't paved, it would hit stones and bounce, and this thing just kept going. And I remember coming around second base and heading toward third, and I'm around in third base heading home, and I hear Mom. Ronnie and Keith, it's time to come in and do the dishes. And I'll tell you, if there ever was a downer, here I am, a macho baseball player, and I was convinced I was the only boy in that town of Jim Thorpe that ever had to do dishes. I hated it, absolutely hated it with a passion. We'd argue, you washed last week, it's my turn to dry. No. You dry last week, it's my turn to dry. And we'd argue, hoping Mom would say to us, okay, I got enough. You guys get out of here, and I'll do it myself. Well, she was smarter than that. She said, okay, I'm leaving. I don't care how long it's going to take you to finish it, but you stay until it's finished. I'll probably be back in about an hour or two, and I'll check up on you. So that didn't work. I'm going to fast forward about 10, 15 years. The Twin Pines camp. There was a girl up there, Twin Pines, that I met. Her name was Deanna Lumberman. I would visit Deanna. I was going to college in out of town, and she was going to college at Penn State. Her parents were gracious enough that they would invite me to their place, and they let me come there, and I would stay over for the Friday and Saturday, and then sometimes I'd come back to Allentown. But we'd go to church on a Sunday morning, and when we came back from church, we'd sit down and we'd have a meal. And Deanna was one of three girls, and so their job was to help clean up. And one day I was there, Sunday I was there, it was Deanna's turn to do dishes. And so I got up out of my seat and I walked over to the sink and I said, let me do the dishes for you. I love dishwater. I love dishwater. I love dish towels, I love dish rags, I love that's what I have in the sink. Everything about the dishes I love, let me do it for you. What made the difference? I was performing according to the expectation of the one I love the most. I do anything for Deanna. And by the way, I still do dishes. The change. Because of the person I loved, I would do anything. And when I read that having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them, that was telling me that Jesus loved me and loves you more than any would go to a cross and lay down his life for his friends. He performed according to the expectation of one another most.
What's the greatest commandment?
Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself. Jesse read it for us. Because if that happens, God's not going to worry about us. Because if we love him with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, he knows we're in a good spot. And if we love our neighbors as ourselves, he knows we're in a good spot. And he showed us what that was all about and what it looked like. And so we're able to have a good example and follow that example that he placed before us. So having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them. What did he show them? The full extent of his love. He showed them the full extent of his love. Paul says this, he made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death on a cross. That's the cost Jesus paid because of his loyalty and his love for you and me. A number of years ago, I was in Allentown. I was early for a meeting. And in newspapers, you know, there are these classified ads in the back of the paper. And every so often, I'll just look at the cars. And some rather interesting ads, classified ads for cars were in there. Let me share a few of them with you. Now, keeping in mind that in 1 John, the same guy who said, having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them, said this. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. Now, that reveals that God is willing to pay the ultimate price for us. For people that are as is. Here's some from that Avatar paper. The Jeep CJ5. Good chassis, good engine, needs transmission, has no body. 1969 International Dumpster. Best thing they can say about it after listing what's missing, it did include a dump bed and it had new paint. The 1995 Geo Tracker, front end damage, but a new stereo and a speeder. And my favorite was a 1974 Plymouth Duster. No engine, no transmission, no tire, but a few extra parts. Now you sort of get the picture. If you buy one of these things, you know what you're getting. None of them are going to cost you much. In fact, some of them didn't even have a price. Just make an offer. I want to get rid of this thing. Now compare that to a 2003 Hummer. It was listed, all options, chrome package, two TVs, DVD player, heated leather seats, much more. Cost, $50,000. Now you sort of get the idea. You get what you pay for it. That's our understanding of life. Covetous are supposed to be equal. And it makes sense. Nobody's going to pay $50,000 for a 1974 Plymouth Duster that has no engine, transmission, or title, and just has a few extra parts. But let me tell you something. That's exactly what God did. He looks at people like you and me, who often have no heart, no passion, no morality, no righteousness, nothing that is of any more value than a bag of filthy rags. What did he pay for it with? He laid down his own life for his friends. That's show them the full extent of his love. And that's just what God does for us all the time. He just unloads his love for us in spite of the fact that we just mess up and really burden up life a lot. That's why we're here this morning, and that's what communion reminds us of. About a man, a Savior, who would lay down his life for his friends. Great thing that somebody would die for a good person, but rare do we find anyone who would die for a bad person. I mean, that's what Jesus did. And so we're like that 1974 Cleopatra. We just don't have a whole lot to offer. But in spite of that, God looks at us and says, you're beautiful. I see tremendous value in you. Limited though you see yourself, you are more than you'll ever understand and realize. In fact, he values us so much that he went to a cross and gave his life for us. That's the Jesus that we serve and love. That's the Jesus we recognize, who we worship, and who, in just a few moments, we're going to be reminded of once again. Let's pray. Father, thank you for being a person of inequality. Thank you for promising us so much and giving us so much. The mean reality of so little to offer. But thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your love. Thank you for giving yourself for us, that we might have hope, and that we might realize we can keep going on in life, and when things get tough and we just sort of get sloppy in our living, that it's okay, because when we fall, your everlasting arms are there to catch us and encourage us to keep going. Thank you for the price you paid. We will never be able to pay that debt, but we're grateful you don't expect us to. You ask in return our love, our adoration, our worship. And as best we can, Father, we want to give that to you each and every day of our lives. In your name we pray, for your sake, we ask it as well as our own. Amen. Amen.